Amen. I'll just read one Bible verse, not that I'm going to kind of expound it, but to remind us. Acts 20:28, be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. So the model of leadership has, I believe, changed over the centuries, really, in terms of how it has its outworking, so that I guess initially, or at least early on in church life, the priest became an isolated figure before the Reformation. He was a single man, celibate, kind of mystical man, a man who stood on our behalf like a mediator. He knew God, the people didn't. The laity didn't know God. The priest was the one. You could go and confess to him maybe, but that's how he was seen, a priest. Then, of course, came the wonderful Reformation, and where God made it clear that, hey, we all are priests. We have a great priest who's gone through the heavens. And that whole concept fell away. For we who are Protestant, we celebrate the wonder of access to God directly through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so that kind of mystical figure, that kind of, well, he's kind of set apart from us. With the people, he's the set-apart man in that wrong way went into history. But as time goes by, you find there's, certainly in British history, the clergyman became part of society, rather like the squire, the doctor, and people talked about going into the church, a bit of a professional thing that people did. And sometimes noble families would send their sons into politics, the army, and some the kind of runt would go into the ministry, be a clergyman, and that's the way it was. And then came, yes, enlightenment, argument, and it became more and more argued that, hey, we need our pastors to be well-trained. They need to get degrees so they can answer this this rebellion against Christianity, this kind of scientific refusal. So we find that, hey, a minister and needs to have a degree, needs to have to be able to argue, be highly intellectual. That began to be the whole Bible college concept, the idea of getting a degree. Yes, that's the characteristic. There's been quite a lot of kind of reflection, I would say, of what's happening in society that's affected how leadership has been seen. And then certainly earlier in my life, you found another emphasis coming through as psychology began to become a big feature of modern life. So more and more the pastor, you'll find many, many pastors beginning to take on, you know, how do I give counsel? How do I give therapy, therapeutic concerns, and all sorts of, you know, you have to become almost like a doctor in that sense. And it's like, did anything happen to you in your childhood? Can I unravel you? That began to be part of pastoral training, perspective, again, reflecting what was happening in the world. And then I would say, to bring it right up to date, a pastor's often now seen as to be a manager. He's got to have his five-year plan. He's got to hire and fire. And so we're much more, and if you look at some major pastoral leadership magazines, there much of it's about business skills that we can learn. Now, we don't need to despise business skills we can learn, but I think that it's just, again, another way in which church leadership is kind of learning from the world. The world is showing us ways of leading, ways of dealing with people, and we're kind of reflecting it. So management's the new way. You have to have management, you have to have a management approach. Well, I guess some of that's quite helpful to us in that where the church had become a bit archaic and sleepy, it was provocative to hear these things. But I'm not sure they're meant to shape our view of leading the flock of God. And it brings me to this word, this wonderful word of shepherd, a shepherd. That's the Bible word. Management's about, you know, selling your product, hiring appropriate staff, firing them if necessary. It's a very different feel to the thought of a shepherd. A shepherd has a relationship with his flock. God himself reveals his relationship to his people as shepherd to flock. is very much the main statement of what he, how he relates to his people. Obviously, Psalm 23, many people's favorite psalm, even if they don't really know God very much at all. The 23rd Psalm, the Lord's my shepherd. And so much in that wonderful psalm reminds us of our relationship with him. He's a shepherd to us. And not only there, we find when Jesus comes on the scene, he is announces himself to be the good shepherd, the beautiful shepherd, the wonderful shepherd of God. And in fact, right on to, into Revelation, which for myself, I kind of stumbled on more recently. Yeah, look at that shepherding right into the book of Revelation, where it says in Revelation 7:17, for the Lamb in the center of the throne will be their shepherd. He'll guide them to springs of water of life. So these images of God himself being a shepherd are meant to inform us when we're talking about being pastors. Because many of us would say, well, I'm pastor. What do you do? I'm a pastor. Or sometimes we get called, are we Pastor Smith or Pastor this and Pastor that? But for many of us, you know, growing or living in an urban society, it's possible you've never met a shepherd in your life. I don't think I've knowingly ever met a shepherd. But we use this term, pastor. It's probably the most common term that people use to describe their ministry. I'm a shepherd. That's the way they describe themselves. I'm a pastor. So what are we talking about in biblical terms when we think of shepherding? First of all, I would say this. In the Old Testament, where we first meet it, it has to do with the people of God being on a journey. They are being shepherded on a journey. Now, I think that's very important. Because it's very possible for us to find that there's an emphasis today about shepherding. Well, what you do, first of all, is discover people's felt needs. Where are they wounded? Where are they helped? And so the context of our shepherding could be very static and focused on where you're hurting. And how can I help you to stop hurting? Because I'm a shepherd caring for you. Now, I'll come back to that later, because that's part of our calling, but we must be careful that that doesn't leave us with a church that becomes introspective and need-centered. If a church becomes need-centered, it's forgotten. It's a people on a journey. The people of Israel were brought out of slavery in Egypt on a journey, initially to encounter the presence of God in terms of the cloud of his presence, Mount Sinai, covenant relationship, and then on into inheritance, a land of promise, a fulfillment of promise. That's a journey that they were on. And that journey is referred to in the New Testament, where Paul, writing to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, says about that journey, and he illustrates from it how some didn't make it to the end. They fouled up, they murmured, they complained, they became idolaters and so on, and they didn't get through the journey. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, all these things were written for our instruction. They're an example for us upon whom the ends of the ages have come. So this miniature, this 2 million people traveling from Egypt to the land of promise, they're kind of a miniature. And that journey is for us, this global church around all the world. It's written down for our instruction. What is this flock being shepherded on the journey into their inheritance? So shepherding is not a static affair. It's not just us dealing with need. It is us, yes, keeping the people healthy, caring for them, as we'll come to, but in order to bring them on their journey through. So the people of God are essentially on a journey. They're coming, if you like, from slavery, where we were born. We were born in all kinds of horrible slavery. And God is taking each one of us through his purposes into inheritance, sonship, and all that God has for us, from slavery to sonship, a wonderful journey. And shepherds help people individually on their journey out of all the things that used to tie them up and mess them up into more and more freedom and more awareness. I'm a son of the King. I'm ultimately going to enter into glorious eternal inheritance. But we're taking people on a journey. And if we forget that, we're in danger of the church becoming an introspective group And if we're not careful, we find people who are quite good at meeting felt needs and can build a very big church on it. And then they can say to other pastors, here's your way of building a nice big church based on people's felt need. And we get more and more static people focused on how to help people in their felt needs. And we've forgotten, this is the commission from God. Jesus said, go into all the world, make disciples of every nation. That's the commission. That's the manifesto. Go into all the world. What did the apostles do? They were told, go into the world and make disciples. What they did was go and plant churches. That's what we read in the Bible. Go and make disciples. What did they do? They went and planted churches. That was what they did. But these churches are the fulfillment of this word, go into all the world and make disciples. So churches have to be characterized by that emphasis. And I would personally say that they're foundationally built on apostles, that is sent ones, and prophets, that's people with vision. And then, of course, we want the best pastor teacher that we could ever have, but foundationally, in other words, what gives us our DNA, what we are foundationally, is an apostolic community. We are sent people. Jesus says, the Father sent me, so I send you. The church is a sent people, right from the beginning, fulfilling even the promise to Abraham, going back to the beginning, when God said to Abraham, through your seed, all the families of the earth are going to be blessed. The church is here to fulfill that calling, all the families of the earth. That's our calling, that's who we are, that's why we exist. We're here to fulfill that calling. And I would actually even say this too. It's not that the church becomes static and then a few isolated people become missionaries and go and do world mission. Oh, you go and be a missionary. Go and join that missionary society. Now, that's not to mock wonderful missionaries. Some of these people are great heroes of mine, Hudson Taylor and these terrific missionaries. I honor them massively. But I honestly believe the church's role is to build a body of people being shepherded who themselves then become other. They will shepherd more churches, plant more churches as we go into all the world and make disciples. But so shepherding is not a static thing. It's helping people on their individual journeys out of things that used to be too, they couldn't get free from them. And we'll see as we go through that we would teach them, that sets you free. You know the truth sets you free. You're no longer in that problem. You come out from it. And that we are corporately on a journey to the nations. So some of us will move on and plant another church. And that comes under the care of the shepherds and teachers on the journey. So we are shepherding a moving congregation. Now, how did God do it in the Old Testament? Well, his presence was with them. He manifested his presence through the cloud of glory. And that's what made God's people unique. God chose Abraham. God chose the nation of Israel, not because they were the greatest, but because he loved them. He covenanted fellowship with them. And he manifested his presence. And at one point, he, through their rebellion, making a golden calf, God threatened them, I won't go with you. And Moses cried, Lord, if your presence doesn't go with us, we're not going anywhere. Because it's your presence that makes us unique. You're not manifesting your presence in Brazil or China or Europe. You know, it's this people, this one nation in the whole world that have this incredible privilege. The presence of God goes with us. And so Moses said, if you're not coming with us, hey, we don't want to go anywhere, because that's what makes us unique, distinct. God's with us. He was a shepherd who was with his flock. A shepherd then is one with his flock. He's with the flock, manifestly so. If he's not there, hey, then no people really. And so he was there. He's initially the cloud and then, of course, the tent of meeting. He among the people of God, his presence with them. Next, he was protective of them, right? So a shepherd is protective. He cared for them. It was God who rescued them from Pharaoh initially, powers that were far too great for them. God lifted them out. God protected them. When the Egyptian army pursued them, it was God who dealt with that. God protected them. God led them in a way that they didn't face conflict too early. It says plainly, he led them so they wouldn't hit warfare too quickly. And then later, when they did hit warfare against Amalek, instruction was given, prayer was made, and God protected them in their first conflict against Amalek, and he protected them on the journey. And even when you come to Balaam, this kind of false prophet, whatever he was, and he's gone out to curse them, and God deals with this prophet so that all he can do is bless them. Because God's protection is among these people. He says, and Balaam gives some of the one most wonderful prophecies about the people of God in the whole Bible. They're just great, and God's with them, and you can't stop them. And God is protecting them on the journey. And then, fourthly, he provides for them manna to eat, water from the rock, clothing that doesn't wear out for 40 years. Sounds a good idea. God's providing everything they need. So this is how his shepherding is manifest in them. Now, it's good also to notice that not only was God himself ultimately their shepherd, but he manifested that shepherding often through people. Obviously, initially, predominantly through Moses, where we read in Psalm 77, verse 20, "You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses." You led them by the hand of Moses. In fact, it's interesting that God chose men who were already shepherds. Moses was looking after a few sheep when God called him. Even Abraham was a shepherd. Moses is looking after a flock. And then you find a similar thing with David, who's the next key figure in Old Testament history, really. And we read in Psalm 78, "He led his own people like sheep, guided them through the wilderness like a flock. He also chose David, his servant. I took him from the sheepfolds, from care of the ewes with their sucking lambs, and brought him to shepherd Jacob, his people. So he shepherded them according to his integrity and guided them with skillful hands." So initially, David's training, if you like, was with his father's sheep. And David demonstrates such shepherding skill and tenderness and courage, fighting off the bear and the lion. And it's almost like God said, "Wow, if you'll do that for some sheep, I want you to look after my nation." He brings that shepherding care to the nation. God's shepherding is actually worked out through human figures, Moses, David. And then in Jeremiah 3, you get this promise in verse 15, looking to a future day, "I will give you shepherds after my own heart, who will feed you with knowledge and understanding." I'm going to provide shepherding for you. And that's in a context where God is reprimanding the shepherds of Israel, those leaders who should have been shepherding the nation, but were not doing, they were not healing them, they were not feeding them, they were not doing a good job. And Jeremiah says prophetically, I'm going to give you shepherds after my own heart. And you'll find in Ezekiel 34, verse 11, 12, "I myself will search for my sheep. I will care for my sheep. I will gather and deliver them." So God in Ezekiel is saying, I'm going to step on the scene. We've had all these different, probably we're talking about kings who are meant to shepherd Israel. They've not done a good job. I myself am going to get involved. So we come to the day when Jesus steps on the stage and says, I am the good shepherd. Ego, I me. It's that full title. I am that I am. I am. I'm the good shepherd. I'm here. I've come on the scene. God himself stepping down. And notice here it is again. He doesn't say, he says, follow me. That's his invitation. His invitation, follow me, I'll make you. You're on a journey right from the start. Peter, James, John, follow me, I'll make you. And so, yeah, it's the shepherd invites people on a journey. Rather like Moses said to Jethro, remember when Jethro turned up, and Moses says to him, come with us, we'll do you good. And then I can imagine Jethro saying, where are you going? If someone said to you, come with us, he said, where are you going? And Moses goes on and says, for the Lord has promised us good. We're setting out for a place the Lord has told us. We are on a journey. Come with us, not come to us. I think that that static church, that sort of attraction church, come to us, maybe we'll do you good. Moses said, no, come with us, we'll do you good. We're setting out for somewhere. We're on a journey. And then he actually says this to them, and I'll come back to it later. You can be eyes for us. He's giving identity to this new addition to his flock. You come and join us, and actually there'll be a role for you. You can be eyes for us. When people join, who knows what they'll become for us? They will begin to show the part they have to play. But Jesus says, follow me, I will make you. And they came to be with him. It says about Peter and others, Peter left his fishing. He was going to be with Jesus. Mother, like they were under the cloud, now they're with Jesus. That was their experience. Daily, they're with Jesus. And later on, John can write that his life, the life was manifested. We witnessed, we saw, we handled the word of life. This shepherd was very accessible. This shepherd was very close to them. We touched him, and the life was manifest. There was something. We didn't just hear his teaching, we saw a life. We saw a life that enthralled us, excited us. A life that said, come to me, draw to me, come with me, I'll lead you in. So here we find Jesus, and in John 17 you get that wonderful prayer at the end of his ministry, really, when he says, Father, I've revealed your name to these you gave to me. He says, I don't pray for the world, I pray for these. And I pray for those who will believe through them. Because Jesus is forming a new flock. He's coming to backslidden Israel, and yet out from Israel, calling a new people to himself, teaching them, revealing the Father to them, having a life that excites and motivates them, calling them onto a journey, and says to the Father, I've done the work you gave me to do, I've shaped this flock. They know now, I've come from you, and it's by their relationship with him. And so here in Jesus, you get model shepherding. Someone caring for them, watching over them. When Simon Peter messes up, you find that beautiful encounter following the resurrection. Jesus making breakfast for them. It's stunning. Peter's denied him, and Jesus is making breakfast for him. It's a wonderful shepherd. You see him gathering this scattered flock again and setting them up again and getting them ready for the next phase. So again, if I may say, very foreign to the concept of hiring staff, which is now coming, I think, from a business world, hire staff. We had in our conference in England a few years ago a very gifted and well-known teacher from the USA, and he came and he actually said to our pastors section of the whole event, he said, now don't make friends with your co-elders. If you do, it's harder to fire them. Because if you're a proper leader, you have to be able to fire guys. And I thought, wow, that's very different to Jesus, who said to the Father, all that you gave to me, not one of them is lost, except for the son of perdition. I didn't lose any of them. And now this brother's saying, now if you're going to have staff, you have to be able to fire them so you motivate them. You say, wow, it's a million miles. A million miles. Now that would be a very respected Bible teacher, fantastic preacher. But I thought, wow, the way we're doing church, that's very foreign to what we see in the Bible. A shepherd who was so kind and patient, but forthright. Forthright. He said some pretty straight things to Simon Peter, to the sons of thunder. He spoke to them pretty firmly, James and John. He shaped them, he confronted them, he cared for them, he loved them. He was changing them, taking them on a journey, leading them through to maturity, experiencing things. Even fascinating, I've been looking quite a bit lately at how Jesus, he sent the disciples. It says at one point, Jesus healed multitudes. They went up a mountain, 5,000 followed him. and women and children, it says. So D.A. Carson says probably 20,000. 20,000. And Jesus taught them and healed them, taught them and healed them. They slept. Next day, taught them and healed them. They slept, taught them and healed them. And then it says he healed them all. So there's 20,000 people around Jesus. And they've all been... the disciples say, hey, send them away. They've been with us 3 days. They're starving. And Jesus says, you feed them. And he's bringing them into his world. You do it. I should do what? I've got fewer. And I can imagine Jesus. He says that he prayed, blessed the bread, broke it, gave it to them. I can imagine Simon Peter. Thousands of them. Like, me feed? It's like, right, a bit for you, a bit for you. And then thinking, hey, what is happening here? What is happening? What is happening? And being right close in on this phenomenal miracle. And the crowds are waiting for the Messiah. Could this be the one? 20,000, no one's sick here. Now he's feeding them. And it said in Deuteronomy 18, there'll be another one like me, Moses said. Not only another David figure who could slaughter the Philistines. We're looking for someone to get rid of these Romans. Their expectation of the Messiah would be he'd destroy the Roman army and deliver us, like David dealt with the Pharisees. That was the thought. The Psalms of Solomon say very clearly, not a biblical book, but a book that was current. You know, raise him up, send your son, let him smash these Gentiles. Get us free again. And it says in John's Gospel, the account, John 6, it says, so taking him, they were going to make him king. They're going to force their agenda on Jesus. And Jesus, of course, won't allow it. But I can imagine the disciples who were kind of half-formed and saying, when you come to be king, can I sit on your right? Can I sit on your left? You know, even sending their mother along. You know, can my boy sit on your right and sit on your left? And the crowd saying, come and be king. I expect them to say, yeah, make him king, make him king. We're ready. And it says Jesus took them and compelled them to get onto a boat and sent them into a storm. I think, you know, following Jesus is no guarantee that you won't hit storms. And if you are hitting a storm, it's no proof you've lost Jesus. He sent them into the storm. And then he went up a mountain to pray. And they're being trained, dear friends. They're going to be the foundations of this new community. They're being trained that soon this Jesus is going not to be, you won't be able to see him. He will have gone up through the heavens. So this training program, send them into the storm. I'm going to be up in the mountain praying. Now we have a great priest who's passed through the heavens, who's praying for us. And he comes and rescues them. But he's training these disciples. He's shaping them up. Because they were in danger of getting a wrong picture of what this kingdom was going to look like. He's the king and I'm with him. And Jesus said, no, you're not even there yet. There's much more. The cross is awaiting me. So Jesus is leading these guys along into further and further revelation. And Paul says this. He said, I want to know him. And I've left everything behind. I'm pursuing him. We're on a journey. Sheep are on a journey. Individually, we're all on a journey. We all hope we know him better now than we did 10 years ago. Feel, hey, I'm moving on, I'm understanding. Well, things that used to alarm me don't alarm me anymore. So Simon Peter can write later in his epistle, don't be surprised at the fiery trial. It's as though some strange thing's happening to you. When he was in the boat, he was thinking, hey, some strange thing's happening to me. But later he's saying, no, don't be alarmed. Jesus has trained me. Because we're on a journey where things that used to fill us with alarm, we begin to handle those things. We begin to grow in grace, confidence in God. We're on this journey with Jesus, individually, but the churches are corporately, and the grand church of God is on corporately on a journey with Jesus. We are being shepherded along by our wonderful shepherd. So Jesus models shepherding himself, and then he commissions his apostles to go. Go, make disciples. That's their commission. Go and make disciples. These 12 are going to create a nation, an international people, a people who are no people, now the people of God, with one shepherd. Amazing God, purpose in God. And so they go, and as we said at the beginning, told to go and make disciples, they go instinctively plant churches, because it's in the churches that we become disciples, where we are shepherded and led. The Holy Spirit, Paul, I read to you a moment ago in Acts 20, Paul says, the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, now shepherd or feed the flock of God. Holy Spirit's made you overseers. So what happened in the early church, the apostles would go from town to town, evangelize, gather a community, build truth into them, and then the apostles would move on. And then he says here in Ephesus, now you elders, you're the shepherds now. Now you watch out for this flock, you care for them, you lead them. So shepherds lead their flocks on this journey. They go before them. Now that's one of the aspects of being a leader. A leader tends to kind of live in the future. It's characteristic of a leader. He looks at the flock and he's got dreams of more. He's got dreams of some further things that happen. He's not a static situation. That's a leader has that about him. He's thinking around the next corner. He's considering the next step. The shepherd goes before the flock. And sometimes that can lead to tension because you're living with the vision that you have, but the people are living with the reality of now. And that's one of the tensions of leadership, and we need to handle that well. We need to not go too far ahead. I don't know if you enjoy watching athletics. I love watching athletics. And sometimes you get a pace setter. And sometimes you get pace setters who are fast, but they're not sensitive to, are they doing the job? And they can sometimes straight out, and before we know where they are, they're 100 yards ahead. And then they're almost a lap. You think, those pace setters are not working because the people are not going with them. They're just striding out, come on, let's go. And they've gone. And they've lost the link. They're no longer drawing the runners with them. It may be that they've been employed to do that. They'll drop out after a couple of circuits, and they're just to get the pace going at the beginning. But shepherds, you don't want to be so far into your future vision that people have lost sight. Where is he? I don't know. I can't keep up with him. But we do have to be ahead. We do have to. It's vision. Leaders, some have within their heart is a visionary perspective. I think about Abraham. It says about Abraham, he left Ur of the Chaldees. It says he set out for a place, and it says he saw a city which has foundations. He'd seen something, he's a visionary. He'd seen a city which has foundations, whose maker and builder is God. Abraham saw down through the centuries somehow, he saw a vision, he saw a city. And it says he left his home. I can imagine him saying to Sarah, come on, we're going, I've seen a city. I can imagine her saying, okay, let's go to see the city then. And then, why are we setting up a tent? Why are you taking me to a tent, Abraham? You said you'd seen a city. But to be honest, we live in the tent because we've seen the city. And for some of us as church planters, you know, you're meeting in your hired hall. I know for us, when we started in a school in Brighton, and the caretaker had forgotten to leave the heat on, you know, in the middle of winter, and you were sitting there saying, thank you, Jesus, oh, this is terrible. Why are we in this? Well, we've seen something. Who knows? A few years' time, we're going to be, hey, we may have our own building. We have a crowd. Hey, there's only this number of us. I've seen that so many times now. Just sat with, you know, a dozen, two dozen people. Now there are many hundreds. Because there's visionary leadership. We will get there. But we've got to learn how to not go too far ahead and how to engage with people and lead them in. We go before, we lead them. It's important. There's something about, I believe that in the main, it says shepherds here, and the word elders, it's always in plural in the New Testament. So at best, it can be a team of leaders. And some of them will be more visionary in their ability to communicate vision and inspire. A vision is a preferable future that you can paint, and people say, yes, I want it. I'll go for it. And then we have to have a gift of kind of inspiration to move people on. And that's why it's important for us to remember again, that's where I'm so nervous of the kind of felt needs vision of local church. Because, well, we're going to move on. How many of us here would move to another town? You think, well, has he got a proper Sunday school work? What about my child? No, I won't have any. Well, I mean, we're just going to hand. I don't think I'll do that. I'm thinking of my children. And what about my job? And what about my salary? And I've got to move. Hey, no. So it won't meet my needs. Well, we're not here just to meet your needs. We're here to reach the ends of the earth. That's how our identity is. Let's go on a mission. That's who we are. That is the flock of God. We're here to bless the world. So there'll come moments when, hey, I'm living in a tent again. I'm back in a tent again. Why? Well, I've seen a city. I've seen what God wants to do in this city. We're going for it. And it's been my privilege and joy to know lots of church planters who've lived in a tent for a while with all the discomfort and all the challenges. But the children's work, there's only 5 teenagers in the whole church. It's tough on my kids and so on. Yes, there are challenges, big challenges. So we have to have a visionary thing that captivates us and takes us through the barriers. So a shepherd leads the flock into the next phase, and he is able to inspire momentum. He leads the flock, not just keep them still. Living in the future with vision that we live for. I guess it's like Moses. You know, come on, I've seen a land of milk and honey. And the people are saying, why are we eating this manna every day then? I hate this manna. Let's go back to the wonderful cucumbers. And he said, no, it's milk and honey up ahead. He's seen something. And that's where shepherds need courage, prayerfully being in the presence of God, to have courage renewed, and if possible, drawing people into that vision that captivates you. That's part of our shepherding responsibility. So we're not static, we're on a journey. And individuals are on a journey too, out of secular values. When we first get converted, some pretty nasty values have shaped our thinking. And we don't understand what life's about at all. And we're justified freely, as John Piper made it so clear this morning. You know, it happens, you're justified freely as a gift. God declares you righteous, hallelujah. We're saved, we belong to God. But for some of us, we've got an awful long way to go to become a mature believer. And we can be ensnared with all kinds of wrong values. And so it may be you've been the son of a very unpleasant father who slaps his wife around or beats his children, and now you're a Christian. And what's your model? Well, my father's the only model of fathering I know. And you're going to need to come out from. You've got to come and learn another way of living. You now you've got to walk worthy of this wonderful gospel, this good news. And so the shepherd must lead individual people. It says in Thessalonians, you turned from idols to serve the living God and to wait for his son from heaven. It's a real 180 degrees turn. You used to worship idols, all kinds of idols, whether it's money, success, my career, all kinds of things captivate people. That's what they live for. We don't want them just to add church going. Sadly, that can happen. That people, they stay in a similar frame. That's what I was like. When I was first converted for a few years, I was virtually unchanged. I started going to church. But my values, the things I lived for, what I got my enjoyment from, that I was still serving those idols. It happened a few years later. One sermon blew me away. I thought, oh God, I'm so sorry. And I turned from idols. I lost all my friends. I lost a way of life. I turned from idols to serve the living God and to wait for his son from heaven. So that's a journey. Individual people, come away from the stuff that you think makes you live, the things you're excited about, the sin that captivated you. Turn from it. That's the journey. Serve the living God. And your whole orientation, waiting for Jesus. Waiting for Jesus. I had the privilege of meeting some Chinese Christians. I'm sure many of us have met Christians from places where certainly historically, it's been tough to be a Christian. Dangerous. Imprisonment. I met a man called Alan Ewan. He was put in prison when he was 44. He was there for 21 years. He had six kids. I could identify, I got five kids. I went to meet him. We were smuggling Bibles into China some years ago. And this dear, wonderful man, Alan Ewan, they let him out. When he was 65, they obviously thought, oh, he's finished, he's an old man now, let him out. He was in prison 21 years. His wife waited for him. Apparently, she was approached by a number of godly men and said, I'll marry you, look after you, look after your children. And she said, he might still be alive. I'm waiting. 21 years. And then they released him. And they were together again. When I met him, he was about 82. They let him out when he was 65. They were back together again. And he came to collect Bibles from us. And he went on his way. I mean, we talked together, you know, waiting for the sun. 21 years. I said, I thought of my children, 21 years of their growth. What is there? No, I'm waiting for his son. I've got a completely different focus, a different value system. We're going to live forever. Jesus is coming. He's put everything right. And it was just a privilege to talk to him and just to hear and think, no, the gospel really. I said to him, you have suffered so much. And he just beamed. He said, nothing compares with the cross. Radiant. And that's funny. I know the next year I was at home and I read an article in a magazine. It said, Alan Ewan is under house arrest because he'd baptized 400 people one day. There's a guy in his mid-80s. He baptized 400 people. They thought he was finished at 65. He's nearly 85. He's baptizing 400. Gosh, wow, it's such a privilege meeting these people. But it's a real completely different value system. It's not just my comfort. Jesus is here for me. Now, Jesus, I'm rescuing you from futility. I want to turn you to serve and to wait. All your hopes for future. A completely reorientation. And part of our shepherding responsibility is to wean people off of false values and bring them into a completely different perspective. We're taking them on an individual journey, changing their values through things that we preach to them, because all sorts of values are taken for granted as being correct. And some are quite pleasant values. And all the time, is that a biblical value? What Peter calls that futile way of life you inherited from your fathers. And it comes masquerading at all sorts of stuff. But Peter says it's a futile way of life that you inherited. We need to bring it to the light. Say, hey, wait, that doesn't fit anymore. That'll have to go, but here's a better way. Here's a better way. And so shepherds have that responsibility. And part of our doing of that is through the preaching of the word. And I did that first plenary session here talking about that people meet with God. Our goal, we've got a goal. We want to present Christ to people in such a way that they say, I don't need that anymore. I need this. So that we pray, and as we preach, say, Lord, let people meet God through this sermon. Let them reevaluate. Let them think, no, I don't need that anymore. I need this now. And so we're looking for people to make the journey. We're looking for them to come with us on this journey. Cultures that get reshaped. And people are brought to the obedience of faith. They're brought out. But they're not brought into religion. That's the big challenge. We're not brought into legalism. We're not brought into, I'm not allowed to do that. We've seen something better. If they've not seen something better, and that's why I so admire John Piper's tremendous writings about seeing something that has captured your heart. And so the other things, like C.S. Lewis was so brilliant about it, with these other things are seen to be, that's ridiculous, nothing that's got no future in it. No, he's the authentic one. Like that lovely parable talks about the kingdom of God is like a man who finds treasure in a field. And he sells everything else to buy the field. It's like, wow, look what I've found. I'll happily sell everything else. Or he's found the pearl And you can imagine, it says he's a man who deals with precious stones. And you can imagine this guy's got, you know, this stone, I got this here that's got history behind it. You know, these very precious gems that have history, you know, that was in the British royal family, that went back to there and there, that's its history. I bought it at a huge cost. This one, Middle Eastern Sheikh had it, he wanted a big, I know, I paid for it. These things, I treasure these things. This is my stock. I've got this incredible jewel I've been carrying. What is that? Wow, that. Oh, you can have all those. I want this. I mean, that's what it's saying. So I found something that changes the value system of all this. It's not, oh, we're not allowed to. We have to leave that. Oh, shame. We've seen something that's blown us away and excited us. And it's part of our responsibility as preachers of the Word of God, as men of prayer and sisters of prayer. We say, Lord, open their eyes. But Paul said, I'm praying for the eyes of your heart to be open. You might know the riches of Christ. And so shepherding is feeding the flock so that they get excited with, wow, that's mine. That's ours together. So we're not beating people up with rules and regulations. So often, sadly, we just use guilt manipulation as preachers. God forbid, that's not the way. Jesus said to the Pharisees, you load them with heavy loads. You don't lift one finger to release them. Come to me. I'll give you rest. We sometimes use that as a kind of psychological message for troubled. In its setting, it's for a people beaten up by religious leaders who are putting rules and regulations on them. He says to them, you load them with heavy burdens. You don't lift one finger to relieve them. Come to me, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, I'm meek and lowly of heart. You'll find rest for your soul. He's saying that to people bombarded by religious guilt and shame and keep the rules. Now come and find rest in me. And then having discovered me, live worthy of this wonderful gospel. Make good choices. Have fresh priorities. Make good decisions in the light of who you now are. What I've done for you. So we have to preach Christ. We have to preach the good news. Preach the grace of God that sets people free. That's our calling. It takes people on a journey. Not a journey out of worldliness into religion, but out of worldliness into the freedom of Christ. Religion's a very sad stepping stone. It doesn't take much. It doesn't give you much. It gives you a heavy burden. So we present Christ. We present grace. We present forgiveness, adoption into the family. No longer under law, but under grace. Massive things we need to teach the flock of God, presenting Christ. And then also, remembering we're shepherds of a flock, it's not just individually. I know for myself, when I was first converted, and my sister told me, I've become a Christian. I said, how'd you become a Christian? I've been born again. I know God personally. That's unbelievable. You know God personally. And then I became a Christian, and that was personal was the big word in those days. You have a personal Savior, and you do personal devotions and personal evangelism, and everything was me and Jesus. That's where the emphasis lay. It's me and me, Jesus. And then when you love the Word more and more and you begin listening to God, you understand, hey, that's not quite the emphasis of the New Testament. It's much more corporate. It's much more together with all the saints we get to know. And we're not to be like little children, Paul says in Ephesians 4, tossed about by every wind of doctrine, but come like a mature man. The contrast is not only with immaturity with maturity, it's contrast with little children, plural, and a mature man, singular. Corporate. You're members of one another. And we begin to learn that the only way you can come to maturity, actually, is through one anothering with others. It's the only way you get there. You cannot become a spiritual Mr. Universe by privately pushing up weights. The way God's made us is we need one another. We need one another. That's how we grow. That's how we grow in terms of sanctification, because we suddenly say, you, and then suddenly we find these fingers are pointed back at us. You've got a beam in your eye. And it's these relational things that I was looking a little, my wife read a book called Women Set Free, and she, the chapter I was glancing at the other day, and just testifying how she came to a stage when I was pastor, she was a wife, and she said, I'm struggling with this lady in the church, and she offends me. She said, I said to God, she'll have to leave this church. And she said, I've forgotten the occasion, but she said in the book, I said to Terry, I'm not coming out to bed. I just need to talk to God about this. She's like, I set it all the things I had wrong with this woman, terrible woman. And she's talking to God about it. And then she sort of paused, and she said she felt her God say to her, that's a perfect description of you. She said, me? Yeah, you're exactly like that. And she suddenly realized, gosh, I thought she was like that. And she said, I had to go to her. I had to get right with God, and I had to get fellowship with my sister. And she said, I knew that God had done a wonderful thing when a little later I realized, if she left the church, it would break my heart. I was blessed just reading that. And I thought, now that is growing in grace, because you're suddenly, that's how pearls are made. You know, this bit of grit gets in there, and it makes a pearl, actually. And it's in the relational setbacks, disqualifications, problems, and suddenly we find our way through and we grow in grace. And that's why we get all this one anothering in the body of Christ. Pray for one another. Confess your faults to one another. And shepherds should set up a flock with sufficient maturity. So it says in Romans, you're full of knowledge, full of wisdom, able to admonish one another. That the saints can admonish one another. We can help one another through. And so one of the points about a shepherd is that you add people to the flock. It's interesting that the way that's described in the book of Acts, it doesn't say 3,000 were saved. It says 3,000 were added. That's right, added. Brought into the body. Added to the community. Salvation, it's in the community. And that's where you grow. You're joined to a body. And that's why, to be honest, Christians who say, well, I don't actually belong to a church. I go there sometimes. I watch a thing on television. No, that's not... You want to be in a body. You need to be in a flock. And to be honest, the shepherds need to know, are you in our flock or not? Are you my responsibility or not? We need to make it clear when people are we your shepherds? Or do you just come here sometimes? So we need to work on that. We need to, like Jesus said, I am the door and I'm the shepherd. So coming into the flock, it should be coming in with a clear understanding of the role of these shepherds. I'm coming within their sphere. I'm coming within the blessing of their gift, because that's how shepherding works, that God calls us and gives us a gift. So that when we speak, the reason they come back again next week is that when you speak, I kind of hear God. God speaks to me through you. I feel... And that's the shepherding gift, that we speak, we prepare our sermons, we work, we pray, we expound, and people feel, I hear God when you speak. And that gives you your sphere of ministry, these people who are receiving from God through you. But it's helpful to say to folk, hey, would you like to join us? And joining us has to do with, I think, Jesus said, I'm the door, I'm the shepherd, and I'm the door. So coming into the flock, there should be a real understanding. I want you to know that I'm in. So sometimes church membership can be a very formal business. Is your name on the list sort of thing? I think becoming a member of a flock is pretty important. It's like, are you in my care? Do I have responsibility for you? Or do you just breeze in here sometimes? So we need to encourage people to say, no, I'm in the flock. And help people understand. I think it's a very good idea, to be honest, to have an introductory program to joining a church. So that if they come, they understand, I am honoring you guys as your shepherds. You're the shepherds here, and I really respect that. And there may be a team leader. He might be called the pastor. But, hopefully there'll be a group of elders. And it's like, I really respect the leadership here. I come in recognizing that. Doesn't mean I can't say, but why do we do that? Doesn't mean we're not allowed to ask any questions. But it does mean that we respect the leadership so we can really shepherd people. Otherwise, we don't know if we've got permission. We may need to say to a guy sometimes, brother, I've just noticed, I don't think you ever listen to your wife. I noticed in conversations you cut her out. Do you ever listen to her? Wait, what? Who gives you the right to say that to me? Well, I'm your shepherd. I thought you gave me that. I thought you came in. I thought you want to grow. And as your shepherd, I've got ambition for your maturity. And Paul says, I'm laboring for you to come to maturity. And so shepherds have this passion to bring people through and get ambition for people and look at backslidden teenagers like it was and pray for them and say, no, I can believe what he could become. And so a shepherd has to have an awareness who are his flock and that people come into an awareness, I'm part of a community now. I'm part of a people. And that's a living link. It's not just I'm on the list. It's not just I sit in that pew. I'm part of a flock. I have a shepherd. And I remember when I first started going to the church and I used to refer to the pastor as Mr. Rudman. And I kept with that and kept with that and kept with that. And then there came a day when I just said, Pastor. And I wouldn't necessarily want to make a big thing of that today. But I knew when I did it, because we didn't have any kind of introductory program in the way that I would suggest we have it now. But I knew I was saying to him, I give you permission. You really are looking after me. Before that, he was just the man who preached here. And I felt I come into a relationship with you. I think it's important. What we call one another is not so important as my way of thinking, but are we in? Are we being part of that flock? And we become aware we're part of a family, a body actually, members. And that's going to be my last point really. Equipping the saints for works of service. So the shepherd has that responsibility. Ephesians chapter 4, Jesus ascended on high. He gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers to equip the saints for works of ministry. That we may all come to maturity. Then it says, we come to that when each part is working properly. So part of our role is to discern gifted men and women and to help channel them into their full potential with all the diversity. It says in 1 Peter chapter 5, as each of us has received a gift, we should serve one another through these diverse gifts. Each has received a gift. So we need to discern. You know, some have got amazing. I remember a lady in our very first church had a gift of hospitality. It was staggering. She used to stand at the door and say, are there any new students today? And I'd say, yeah, there's a few. Send them down. And I would sometimes, Wendy and I would go, and you'd say, how does she feed all these people? She somehow, I don't know, the food just, I don't know how it happened. It was always enough. She had such a gift of hospitality. I've often spoken of her to other ladies. Now, that's a beautiful gift. It helps build a church. People with a gift of hospitality, especially a young, new plant, it's a wonderful gift. Opening your home, feeding people, welcoming people. It's a gift of God. It's in the list, gift. And gifts of administration, all kinds of gifts, can help the body grow, to discern where gifts lie, and to encourage and make space for people. It's part of our role, so that we bring people to maturity. And it's our responsibility to serve the flock. I would say, you know, when I was a first pastoring, you kind of give your energy. I think the temptation with me was the really go-ahead guys, well, they're doing all right. I must go and visit the people who are on the edges. You know, they don't come very often. I'll go and visit these people. And I felt God really spoke to me. He said, give yourself to the hungry ones. Give yourself to those who really want. You know, it's not that you're indifferent to these, but I got the wrong way around, I think. I felt God was showing me, no. This guy would grow so much if you gave him some more. If you fed that family, if you fed that couple, if you encourage that girl through, you encourage, just give yourself to these who are hungry. And I began to do that. I gave myself to the key guys, and the church began to come alive from within. Because you see thirsty ones. Jesus said this, what I see the Father doing, I do. My wife and I used to pray together and say, Lord, who are we meant to be giving ourselves to? And I'd see a couple coming along and say, I'd go and see, have you read this book? And I'd try, because somebody helped me a lot when I started. Just give me books. Just feeding them, giving them things until they begin to grow and reproduce the ministry. And you can equip them for works of service. So we're bringing people out of individualism, out of sin, out of me-first mentality, me-only mentality, to turn away from that and become part of a family. And the language of the Bible, as you well know, is actually body. A flock, a family, a body with individual members. And so, you know, we have a lot of grandchildren, so we've got a lot of babies around. And when you first see a little baby, they're lying there, just lying there. And sometimes they see their hand. You've seen that? They see the hand. Oh, what's that? You know, it's part of me. Oh, well. They're looking at their hands. And then they think toes are for sucking and knees are for walking on. They don't know what the bits are for. Then as they grow up, oh, feet are for walking on. Oh, fingers, they're good at scratching, doing up buttons. And what you find is you don't say hand, chop. Wait on God. Find what the purpose of God for your life is. Hand finds what it's there for by serving the body. Hand can do things. And it discovers its raison d'etre by serving the body. It finds its gift by serving the body. And we want to encourage the church to see its corporateness, see the gifts that are there, and come to a maturity. That will mean encouragement, sometimes correction. Sometimes saying, when you do that, wow, that blesses everybody. Sometimes you have to say, when you do that, it just blows the meeting out. Would you not do that, please? And sometimes people say, if you're speaking to me like that, I'm leaving. That means they learn nothing, sadly. But if they learn well, we can help people to maturity and build a mature body.